Thanks, everyone, and welcome this morning. It's a pleasure to be here. So, Centuria Office REIT, and we're on slide two to start with. Centuria Office REIT is an ASX listed real estate investment trust trading under the ticker code COF. Now, what a real estate investment trust is a unitised property portfolio, in this case, a collection of office assets. And COF is the largest listed ASX pure play office REIT. And what pure play actually means is that we have no other types of assets. So there's no retail assets or other types of assets. And we also don't have any management company associated with the business. So there's no development exposure or management company associated with the REIT. Now, what this basically means is that we own office properties and the income or capital returns that we generate, we pass through to our unit holders. Now, at the moment, COF is offering a very compelling distribution return of over 8% per annum based on our current FY21 forecast. Now, so for those investors that are seeking a compelling income return, we think that COF is certainly worth considering in the current environment, in which it is a very low interest rate environment. So for comparative income generating investments, COF does compare favourably well. Now, outside of the distribution, COF is also in pretty good shape in terms of where its balance sheet sits. So we've got gearing at about 35%, and we've got substantial undrawn debt of over $130 million. So we're in a very solid financial position. Now, turning to the portfolio itself, COF has got a portfolio of 23 office assets scattered across Australia. We only invest into Australian office property, and the value of those assets are about $2.1 billion. Now, in addition to that, we've got very high occupancy within our portfolios. So the current occupancy is about 96%, and we've got a weighted average lease expiry, or WALE, of about 4.5 years. Now, what a WALE represents is the period in which all leases across the portfolio expire, and it's an indication of the income security for that fund. Now, at 4.5 years, that indicates that the average lease across the COF portfolio expires in 4 years' time, which indicates that COF has got pretty good income security into the future. Now, if we turn to the next slide. So this slide summarizes COF's strategic vision and objectives. Now, our vision is to build Australia's leading pure play office REIT, and we do that by focusing on generating sustainable and quality income streams and executing initiatives to create value across a portfolio of quality Australian office assets. Now, what this basically means is that we want to own quality office buildings that attract and retain tenants. We want to tenant those office buildings with high quality tenants that will underpin our cash flow. And we seek to get long lease terms, which give us income security into the future. Now, to do that, we leverage a lot from the broader Centuria platform. So Centuria is the manager of COF, and Centuria has a very wide and deep expertise across all functions of property. So everything from facilities management, so the guys that manage the buildings right through to leasing, capital transactions, asset management, everything is done in-house. And that expertise certainly does give us a lot more insight into the properties than some of our peers. We are not simply a buyer that sets and forgets. We are an active manager that tries to engage with our tenants and all facets of the property to ensure that we are maximising the returns that we can generate for our unit holders. So if we go through to the next slide, on this particular slide, there are some photos of some of the assets that we own across Australia, but it also details some of the things that we consider in setting the asset allocation for our portfolio. Now, firstly, we want a very diversified portfolio, so we don't have any single market concentration. Now, particularly in an environment such as the current COVID-19 environment that we're in, that is certainly positive because we don't have a heavy weighting to Melbourne or any particular market. So if another market was to go into a lockdown similar to Melbourne, we wouldn't be particularly adversely impacted. The other thing to consider and is in regards to connectivity to transport. Now, one of the key criteria for employee satisfaction is the commute to work, so both time and how pleasant that commute is. So it is essential that our office buildings are very well connected to transport. So that has certainly influenced some of our recent acquisitions, such as buying in South Everleigh, which is near Redfern in Sydney, and also somewhere like Fortitude Valley in Brisbane, because they are both next to current excellent transport connectivity that is also improving. So that is something that we always consider. Now, in addition to that, buildings not only need to be accessible, they also need to be convenient. And what we mean by that, they need to be surrounded by substantial amenities so that employees or tenants within those buildings can get done what they want to do with their normal lives. So it's essential that these buildings are also surrounded by things like childcares, gyms, bars, restaurants, and just your general shopping. So that is also another consideration that we look at when we are looking at our asset allocation. Now, in terms of the average asset age of our portfolio, COF has got one of the youngest office portfolios that you can invest into, with an average asset age of about 16 years. And what that means is the majority of our office assets have been built post the year 2000. Now, 16 years may sound like it is a bit older than it otherwise would, but when you consider some of the iconic office buildings that you see in CBDs across Australia, so if you think in Brisbane, the Riverside Centre would be over 30 years old. In Melbourne, 101 Collins Street would be over 30 years old. And in Sydney, Australia Square would probably be close on 60 years old. An average asset age of 16 years is very, very young. Now, when you look at some of the assets that we own through those photos, you probably notice that we don't own a lot of CBD stock. Many of our assets are located in metropolitan or near city markets. Now, we like those markets for a number of reasons. But primarily there are a couple that I'll highlight now. Firstly, that these markets are obviously more affordable than CBD markets. So affordability is going to become a bigger issue, particularly at the moment when many tenants are focused on their ongoing operating costs. And the average rents that are paid in the markets that we're invested into are materially less than what you'd be paying in, say, the Sydney CBD. So by comparison to the Sydney CBD, many of the markets that we're invested into would be over 50% cheaper than the Sydney CBD itself. The other thing to consider with these markets is, in a lot of cases, they are more accessible than getting into a CBD. So getting back to that point I raised earlier about connectivity, it is sometimes easier to access metropolitan locations than the CBD itself, and that commute is generally a lot more pleasant because you're not on crowded trains or buses trying to get to that central point. If we turn to the next slide, this just gives a bit more detail on the portfolio itself. So as indicated, we have got a truly geographically diversified portfolio. So we're now on slide five, or the next slide along. So we've got exposure to most of Australia's major office markets. Now, outside of not that diversification, the other two key things to consider with the COF portfolio is the tenant mix and tenant profile. And I'll just note that slide still has not updated. So one of the key attributes of the COF portfolio is that over 80% of our income is derived from very, very high quality tenants, being government, listed, or multinational tenants. So what this means is the income that we are generating across the COF portfolio is coming from very, very high tenant quality covenants, which should give investors comfort that the income distributions that we're generating will be sustainable into the future. The other thing to consider is that the size of tenants across our portfolio. So the vast bulk of our tenant profile, so this is the pie graph at the bottom left of the slide. Most of the tenants are over 2,000 square metres, so most are very large tenants. Now, these two points are very important because it does somewhat dispel the misconception that metropolitan or near city markets may have an inferior tenant quality than what you would have within the CBD itself. So we've got very high quality tenants, but also very large tenants across our portfolio. If we just skip through to the next slide, just highlighting further the quality of our tenants, about 25% of our income comes from government alone, and our largest tenant is the Australian Federal Government, who have got about 14% of our portfolio. Now, outside of that, another key consideration about the sustainability of income and our ability to continue to provide, you know, circa 8% distribution returns into the future is the weighted average lease expiry graph at the top right hand of that slide. Now, what that indicates is that over 60% of leases across the COF portfolio expire at or beyond FY24, which means that most of our leases don't expire for at least 2 to 3 to 4 years. So the ability to continue to provide sustainable quality income streams is very strong. Now, if we just go through to the next slide, and I'll quickly touch on the COF performance through COVID-19. Now, COF has performed strongly through, or it's been very resilient through this period. Now, this is something I would like to highlight because there is a misconception or there is a belief that office properties have been impacted in a similar way to, say, retail properties. But that certainly has not been the case within the COF portfolio. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that we have got those very high, large tenants within our portfolio. So looking at rent collections, COF has had rent collections of near on 94% since April of this year. So we are maintaining very high rent collections. And another point that is worth highlighting here is that, and some people may be aware, but commercial landlords, it has been legislated that we are to provide ongoing rent relief to small to medium-sized enterprises that have been impacted by COVID. So we have to provide rent relief commensurate with the impact that COVID-19 has had on their operations. Now, when you compare the fourth quarter of FY20, so the period of April to June, compared to July to September, we saw a 60% reduction in the rent relief that we provided, and that rent relief was only about $1 million, which in the scheme of our portfolio is quite small. Now, if we go through to the next slide, it's probably worth touching on the impact that working from home is having on office properties and what impact that we think that will have going forward. Now, before I talk specifically about working from home, it's probably two things I'd probably like to highlight. Firstly, when you look at those two bubbles at the right of that slide, you can see that white collar employment growth is a growing part of Australia's employment makeup. Now, the thing to consider is that white collar employment growth is the driver for tenant demand going forward. We think that white collar employment growth will continue to go into the future, which will underpin office demand going forward. The other thing to consider is the two bubbles beneath that, and that highlights the amount of people working from home from two census data periods in 1990 and 2016. And what you can see is there wasn't a material change in the amount of people working from home despite significant technological advancements during that same period. Now, what that indicates is that before working from home was forced upon us, many people were not choosing to do it. Now, whilst working from home has been forced upon us, and it has worked for some people, we do not think that that will replicate an office environment going forward. And there's a couple of reasons for that. Firstly, it's very hard to maintain professional relationships working from home. Doing Zoom calls certainly does not replicate face-to-face interactions. It also may be more efficient to work in an office environment, where you've got all the infrastructure around you that is required to do your job. And there are other things that are worth considering. An office environment creates work-life balance. So speaking with tenants, one of the key, there's probably two types of employees that they've noticed within their operations since working from home. Those people that are now probably watching too many episodes of Days of Our Lives, and they've noticed a material reduction in productivity. And conversely, there are people that can't separate their work-life balance and are probably working too hard. Now, neither of those situations are a good outcome, because if you're working with no work-life separation, that leads to fatigue and some pretty adverse mental health issues. Now, the other two considerations for office environments is very hard to maintain culture and onboard particularly young and new staff in a working from home environment. It's also very inequitable. And what I mean by that is working from home can be quite successful if you've got a home office environment. But particularly for young staff who can't afford that and are living in a share house, it's very difficult to maintain productivity when you're working on the edge of your bed with a laptop. Now, just going through to the next slide, because you may feel that I am somewhat biased, being a fund manager of an office REIT, in my opinion that commercial office remains core to business operations. But what we've got here is a number of quotes from particularly tech companies, and all these quotes are in the recent past, so they're all from the last 1 or 2 months, and all of them are indicating support for returning to an office environment. Now, this is particularly important because you'd assume that tech companies are the most able to successfully work from home, but also they are probably the companies that are most stand to benefit from working from home. So I think it's interesting that they are following the path that other companies, other IT companies have had, such as HP, IBM and Yahoo, who have all had working from home operations in the past unsuccessfully, that have reverted to a central workplace after noticing that their productivity has fallen. Now, probably the most, I think, succinct or relevant quote here is from Mark Golan from Google, when he indicates that people are very efficient doing their work from home when they know what they're doing. The problem is what comes next. And speaking to one of the tenants within our portfolio, what they said about working from home is that they have survived, but they're doing nothing. And what they are basically indicating by stating that is that when everyone knows what they're doing at home, it works well. New business, new ideas come from interactions, particularly unstructured interactions. So not formal meetings, but unstructured interactions that occur after meetings or by the water cooler or in the kitchen. And they are simply not seeing that across their business, and that's what they're lacking. So that is something they're very concerned about going forward. It's not about people being able to do what they've done in the past. It's about what comes next. And I think we are starting to see that very strong desire for tenants to get back into their workplace so that they can start generating the next idea or next business venture for that tenant. So if we go to the next slide, just in summary, we have got, we're very firm of the view that Australian office markets will continue to perform well over time as white-collar employment growth continues to grow and tenants return to the workplace. And we think that COF in particular is very well placed given that we provide quality, affordable office accommodation and that our portfolio is underpinned by very, very high-quality tenants. And we've got a very staggered lease expiry profile with over 60% of leases expiring at or beyond 2024. So we are very comfortable in our FY21 distribution of 8% distribution yields paid quarterly.
Thank you, Grant. Sorry to jump in on you there, but we're right on time.